My name is Dean, and you're watching Sequencer Talk. Today, I have a special guest for myself, a good friend, DJ Zadonik, and here he is. Hello.
How guys
are you doing today? Fine,
I'm doing great, man.
Finally, the time for taking the second try to do this talk.
Yeah, I can't believe it's like the 10 plagues of Egypt. We're against this recording, but we finally made it happen.
Yeah. How was your day?
Great. I went to see some friends of mine that invited me over to bake cookies for Christmas. So we baked cookies and I had some curry chicken with rice and yeah, I just walk around. They live next to this really beautiful forest and, you know, it's winter forests are, I mean, if there's one nice thing you can do in winter is go into the forest. It just looks beautiful. So we went for a walk for a bit, just walking the dog. And then, yeah, basically I came back over here because I didn't want to miss my appointment with you. Because for those who don't know, we were taking forever to finally make this happen. And today I had the time and I'm glad we could
really
make this happen
great,
today.
Yes. And you sure, had eggnog, air liqueur. That's,
there you go.
With
eggnog.
Egg. Yeah.
A little bit. So like I'm not too much to be like, you know, I think I could still hold on a pretty fluent and coherent conversation with
we will see.
And when an immigration official, as in I'm not drunk, but you know,
okay,
just a little bit to sort of wake myself up, I guess.
Yeah, nice. Introduce yourself. What are you up to and where do you come from? I know you from Venezuela.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I was born in the city of Barquisimeto, Venezuela, which is about 4 hours west of Caracas. And it was a beautiful time until I moved out. I moved out in about 2014. I lived for 3 years in the U.S. working for several people, just the clients as a producer, mix master engineer, just doing remixes, playing shows, mostly in Europe, to be fair. And then that's why I ultimately took the leap to come to Europe. I always wanted to live here, to be honest. It was always my place of choice. And yeah, I've been here, you know, meaning not as a tourist, but with the whole the Aufenthaltstitel, all the documents that you require to be here legally and to be able to work for about over 5 years now. So in a week, I should be getting my permanent residence in the EU, which hopefully will open a few more doors for me. And I guess I'm hoping it will make life a little bit easier for me here because I intend to stay here for the foreseeable future. It's a place that I'm in love with since I saw it the first time, since I would study it in my school books. So it's a bit of a, you know, to me, it's like an open air museum. So it's everything I see is beautiful here.
Mm, that's nice. Fine. Mm. Fine. You're making a German bass mixed with industrial and metal and.
You could say so. I mean,
yeah, in some ways.
Yeah. Yeah, the thing is, I mean, one thing that I do when I'm writing music is that I always try to convey feelings. I mean, that's literally what it is. I mean, to me, music is a translation of human emotions. So the way I see it is, you know, it just depends on which story I'm trying to tell on a track. So I go through different styles depending on what they inspire me. And so that's why you find that what I write is there's a few things that connect all of the tracks. Like people have told me that I do have a certain signature sound, but at the same time, you can still see like the styles are sometimes a little bit different in between those tracks. Because, you know, sometimes I'm writing the track that I want to use for my DJ sets in the dance floor, or sometimes I'm writing a track that I feel will be great to listen to at home. that doesn't necessarily work in the dance floor, but I want to do it anyway. So, yeah, I can.
So you're not limited to career music. So you can also make music just for your own, and then release it.
I mean, if you don't do it like that, I believe at least that you, it's not fun anymore. I mean, it already is a little bit of a, well, I don't want to call it a chore, but there's a difference between doing music because you want to and doing music because you have to release something, because you have to stay relevant, because you have to pay the mortgage or whatever the hell, taxes. So it's this whole living the dream thing. Yes, of course, it's a beautiful thing. It's something, there's a reason I keep doing it. Like, it's not, I could quit anytime if I really wanted to. But the thing is, I don't want to. So it's still the life that I enjoy and that I choose to have. But a lot of people, you know, they seem to believe that it's all the, I keep thinking back in German as a living is kein Ponyhof.
So it's
not all flowers and rainbows. You know, there's always, it's a job, ultimately. It's a job that I very much enjoy, but you still have to treat it like a job. You still have to treat it with, you have a responsibility now. It's not just like you're making music because you feel like it. You have a responsibility to release music, to make connections, to, and if you are working with a team, with a label or something, they also expect to make their money. So that they're helping me, but I also have to help them. Like, what's the point of a label investing their time and money in an artist if he's not making anything? So I can't afford having burnouts or a breakdown, or I don't have my muse anymore, or I have to take a hiatus. How do you say this? Like, take a break. Hiatus, take a break from music. I can't afford that. But the good news for me, at least, is that I don't have to, because I know exactly how to handle myself in that regard. I never wait for inspiration. I stop waiting for inspiration because I realize you're like, life goes on and you never find it. I put my finger and the keys on the knobs and I start writing ideas, and then I get motivated and then I get inspired. I get inspired by sitting down in front of the computer and working on whatever music just for the hell of it. Sometimes I have like an idea that I really want to write down. Sometimes I'm in front of the computer when I'd rather be, I don't know, laying down in bed watching Netflix, but I still do something, and it takes me like 10 minutes. I'm just doing random stuff, and suddenly I'm like, hey, this is,
that's cool.
What happens if I add this? And then I'm like, and then suddenly I'm inspired. So I guess this is how I managed to stay creative and to have a consistent output, so to say.
What is your favorite tool to start with?
That's a good question. Right now, disappointingly so, considering that I have a room that's surrounded with synths.
It could be something in the DAW or the DAW himself.
I've been working so much in the DAW, but it's because I realized something. It's a very first world problem, but it is what it is, and I have to find a solution for it, and I got it. I just have to execute it. I remember I had a workspace where I had all my synths in front of me, and maybe some on the side, of course, because, you know, at some point you get too many things, and then I might actually have to get rid of a couple of things just to make space, because I want to be able to have as many synths as I can and as many effects as I can in front of me. Because when I get into this creative flow, I'm always working with what's in front of me, because it's like you're almost like an alpha state, so to say, like the same way when you're driving a car. So you can't just go to the back of the car to reach for the, what do you call this? The gearbox.
Yeah.
Right. You don't do that. It's right there next to you. So you're like in this alpha state where you're driving, and then you're like, and the whole body works in a way that's almost like, you know, your brain and the car are one thing. So the second you interrupt that flow, then things just become so much slower. And at that point, then you don't want to do it anymore. So what I did my workaround was, you know, I would take days just to dedicate myself to a specific synth, and then I would start making my own sample packs and my own loops and just hit record and do random things. And then I would cut these down and then divide it in different sounds. Then I would sort of create my own sample packs to then build tracks from. And it was a nice way. But then I still ended up working in front of the DAW much more. Whereas before, I just used to have everything right there. So I didn't have to take one day for sample making or sound design. I would just have it right there and then. And if I want this sound, I go to this synth and I use that. So essentially these days, the two things that I'm using the most are the Malevolent, because it's here. I obviously love how it sounds, but it's also like the form factor definitely helps, because I can fit it in this desk. I'm going to have to change the desk at some point, and it's already in the plans. Just like, I don't want to build like a humongous desk either, but just something where I can at least place all my synths so I can continue with that flow. And the other one, which was a more recent acquisition, sadly didn't make it into my album because the album was almost done by the time I got it. But I think it's going to be on my next tracks for sure. It's the Noran Mono. That thing sounds so cool, man. It's gnarly. I really like the things you can get out of it. So
that's funny. Those two synths are the biggest connection with you and me. So
I would say so. And you can still, that's something else I realized. Another reason why I want to change the workspace.
Yeah.
All of these synths can interact with each other outside the box, and I want to be able to do that. So, you know, if one is too far away from the other, then you can't. Like, I have at least four or five here that are like, I didn't really want to get into the Eurorack format because I know I'm gonna go bankrupt. I'm just gonna buy too many modules, so I've stopped myself.
Little case, DIY case from Exploding Shed, Leaf Audio. Yeah. I worked for them some time ago, and they have now a DIY case with a lid. This is a wooden case, and you have a lid that you can use as a stand. And it's completely cool because you can close it and take it with you. So I started, and I have my DFAM in there, and at this time I test now the Hector from Poly Effect. That's a modular in itself as a whole thing, and then has the whole stuff from Mutable Instruments inside for around 500-600 euros, and you have the plates and stuff and everything marbled.
So it's like it contains the
Like you have a screen on it, and you can patch all your things inside. That's the reason why I try to start with this stuff, and I love Eurorack, but it can be a money grave.
So this is why I'm not in it. I mean, but it's the only reason, because obviously I love it. Like the last time, I mean, Superbooth is pretty much 50% modules. So you have to be into it, obviously.
It's, give me that shit.
It's really inspiring, especially for like these guys from, you know, the Winter Modular guys. And there's this other company. They're always together. They're always collaborating. They collaborated for this thing they call the Eloquencer.
I don't know what you mean.
It's a monster thing. They had like a whole techno set going on just for those modules. And I was, you know, trying to understand what was going on. And all I did was just like play with the envelope. And I was already there. Like, you know, I felt like I was DJing. And that was when I was like, okay, dude, what happens if I just get a bunch of these modules and then I just start a techno project? I really thought that. Just take away with, you know, having an excuse to use the modules. And then I was like, no, I'm not going down this rabbit hole. I guess at some point I will, but right now it's not dangerous. The time.
I see you have some very big other machines here, but where did you start it? So where does the little Frederico in Venezuela started?
Of course.
Whole journey. So what was your first synthesizer? How did you get your first musical job, and for, especially how did you start it with DJing? Because that's something to make clear. You're not just a musician, you're also a DJ.
Yeah.
So
I think it's a bit of, I don't know. I think there's a lot of things that influence your decisions and you don't even notice it. But I guess I can go back and connect everything that I do with, like, I can give you a list of 20 things that, for example, my dad liked Pink Floyd and I loved the sounds and I had no idea where they were coming from. Then when I was a little kid, I was always fascinated. Don't ask me why. I love piano keys. I think it's just like they suck you in. Like you see all these white and black keys and the contrast and the way they're laid out. I think they're just so elegant. And it always caught my attention. I mean, it's something so silly. Just the fact that, you know, the way they look, I'm like, what is that? And then there's a key and you push it and it makes a sound. And to me, this was mind blowing. And I think with like 3-4 years old, I got this little Casio synth. My brother got another one, and then I later actually found it in eBay Kleinanzeigen. Well, not the exact model, but a similar model, which was it's here. Hold on, this thing. Bam, the Casio Tone Bank SA20. So he had the SA10, which is the exact same one, but just with one speaker. The colors were different. Like these keys were like orange and whatnot. Just, I guess they were just.
There were plenty from this around. And I had a similar one. There were even some with a DJ wheel on it.
Yeah. I mean, they create a lot of like. there is this one that it actually went up in price because someone made a reel on Instagram and it got like, I don't know, millions of views or something. And I thought about getting it myself, but yeah, it's essentially one of the first lo-fi samplers. Like you could just record into it, like something similar to this, but you could record into it and then you could use that sample and play it. And, you know, we obviously didn't, there were a lot of things that we wouldn't get in Venezuela, not because I think you could, I mean, if you looked hard enough, you could find things. Like I know people who had Minimoogs. A cousin of mine got his hands on an ARP 2600, which is like, and I only knew about this first because of the older, like the first Arturia plugins back in the day, you know, the first ARP 2600V. And then I was like, oh, wow. Oh, this is what they used to do the R2D2 sound with. I obviously used it in a different way. I love the sound of the ARP 2600. And then he basically told me, you know, I was telling him about all this stuff, like, yeah, I'm doing music and I'm using these plugins. And he's like, oh, I had that thing at home. What do you mean you had? How did you have it? And why are you telling me this in past tense? What did you do with it? He's like, yeah, you know, I'm not really a keyboard player. So I swapped it for a couple of Fender Twin Reverb amps. So, okay, fair enough if you're a guitarist. But I still think, I mean, I'm not sure, man, like an ARP 2600, like the price of those things these days in good condition of a vintage ARP 2600, I think it surpasses the price of two Fender Twin Reverbs. So, but you know, fair enough. You know, he was a guitarist. And
in the 90s, we had a big selling point of big sales of old vintage stuff that nobody wanted anymore. So when all the digital stuff started with the DX and from Yamaha and stuff, nobody wanted this stuff anymore. So
yeah. Okay. And now it's making this comeback.
How did you started to DJ? Did you start it before? Do you did your own music or was it later?
No, it was later, but electronic music has always been in my life. Like I said, that's something. I'm really sorry about this. It's my, I'm not sure if I am ADHD or something, but I keep going off topic. I try to go back to, because I was trying to connect with that. I had all these little things that happened like in my life, from my dad listening to Pink Floyd, me liking synthesizer sounds, my brother getting me to listen to metal when I was 13 after I've been afraid of the music forever because, you know, this is satanic music and I grew up in a Catholic school and my parents, you know, all this crap, all this theatrical bullshit that we all believed back then. And it was nice to believe it. So metal came from my brother, the one who had the synth I have here. Then my dad listened to Pink Floyd. So synthesizers, I found that there. They also listened to classical music. So I had a little bit of I didn't really study a full music career, but let's say I had a little bit of training in a way. Like I spent a while going to music school as a kid, nothing too serious, but I had an idea of how it was. And then after that, I started listening to all these DJ mixes on the radio. It was mostly like this old school rave stuff. It was specifically the sound that I fell in love with. It might not have been the fanciest of it, so to say, but I remember being as young as 6 years old and they were playing, I'm not sure if you remember, I'm not sure if this was popular elsewhere in Europe, but there was this very specific sound that happened in the Spanish rave scene called, they called it the Bacalao, which was stuff like Chimo Bayo, Paco Pil. It was essentially like techno rave, but they were creating a very specific sounds, lots of super sauce. Lots of super sauce, okay. But it wasn't trance either. You know, it sounded a little bit heavier than what you would, not so refined as what, like, say, Tiesto started doing or Armin van Buuren after that. It was a bit more of a raw sound. And this was the sound that I started liking when I was a kid. But I'm talking, you know, me being 6 years old, I didn't really have. I didn't really know if I wanted to make music or not, but I remember myself recording these sets on the radio, and then the moderator would start talking. Bienvenidos a la mega estación 93.3. Paco Pil con la canción. I hated that stuff, so I would pause it, go back to the first beat right before he started talking, and then I would hold the pause button and let it go whenever the next beat would start right after the moderator stopped talking. So I was beat matching when I was 6 years old, and I just figured this out like years later, like, oh crap, like, yeah. So
it's,
I guess,
funny, it's exactly the same thing I did also.
So there you go.
That's amazing. We are the same age, so it's funny. And the funny thing is, for tapes are back in a certain way.
Yeah,
more.
I've seen it.
I really like it.
Same.
But yeah. And when did you started to DJ with the first?
Like gig? First time I actually had a gig. I was using Traktor back in the day. Just with my computer, like talking my desktop computer, which had like this white cream color case, is really vintage. The CRT monitors, like, and I would bring that whole behemoth right into the club just to mix with Traktor using my typing keyboard because I had no MIDI controller. So I basically configured the software so I could mix with my typing keyboard, which was possible back then. Mm-hmm. And then that's how I would do my sets. A lot of people thought I was playing live, but I was just not able to. I didn't know how to DJ. And I did it for like a year and a bit. And a few friends of mine, you know, I was bugging them around all the time so they would let me play at their parties. And they saw that, you know, they could see the talent, but they were like, I was definitely not there yet at all. Like, these guys were really good at DJing. And then they finally, one day, take me like, hey, man, we want you to come over for a sec. We want to have some beer. Like, just invite. They invited me over to their place. And they're like, okay, man, listen, we want you to play at this party. And it's going to be a really big deal. And you can't break that computer anymore. Like, it's about time you learn how to do this shit properly. and they gave me what they had back then, which was the older Denon CDJs, the little ones. I think I still have them, actually, the ones that I learned to play with. They're back there. You had this thing, like this wheel on top where you could manipulate the effects. They had some effects, basically. Each of the units had their own effects. And you could manipulate them with that jump wheel. Yes. Mm-hmm. I love them. I thought it was great. I actually had I was very, very how to say, I had a lot of they're very skilled with those little things. I was in love with them because of the way you could. I would even barely use the mixer. I would just use like the high pass here. Whenever something else would drop, I would just do this. High passing one channel and then bring in the frequencies back in the other channel, as opposed to using the equalizer and the mixer. And it was so much easier for me, you know? And then I would just do this, do that, take this track out, play the other one, add some flanger thing, add some looping. I was really into trying to add a little bit of a live element to the DJ sets. And right after that, you know, everyone started using Pioneer. It sort of became a standard. And then, okay, I have to learn how to use the Pioneer ones. And Pioneers did not have... you know, these Denons had this little pitch bend buttons, so it's much easier for me to be matching using that, like just a little bit like this. That's how I learned. And then the Pioneers didn't have that, and I'm like, so why would these people try to make everything so much more complicated just for the hell of it? Like, why do I have to emulate the feeling of a vinyl? I did not learn with a vinyl. So I'm sorry if I'm not old school enough, I'm not real enough. I never cared about this shit, you know. It really doesn't. It really doesn't. But then the sync button happened, and then I just started using the sync button. I don't care. I don't care what anybody tells me. I'm like, dude, I make my own music. I play what I want, and I perform the way I want to perform. If someone says that you can only have value if you do the extra job of doing the beat matching on you know, on the fly, well, let me fill you in a secret. A lot of these DJs were basically tempo matching the tracks before they loaded them in the CDs, so they didn't have to beat match anyway. That's what a lot of people were doing. You know, a lot of these bigger DJs were doing that. So it's the exact same thing as having the sync button, just with the difference that maybe you have to be a bit more precise of when you hit play and then just bring it back a little. But they would tempo match all the tracks to one specific tempo before they loaded them in the CDJs.
Yeah, that's the funny thing. Yes, if you are creative in mixing, you don't have to rely on all this normal stuff. That's the same thing I do. I have, I still use Traktor and my old Vestax VCE 400.
Nice.
From 2011 or 12. And this thing is, for me, it's a second nature. It's completely... I can do this blind.
Yeah. Exactly, because you're used to it.
With a little Launchpad Mini on the side for effects, and then I go crazy. And I can little bit beat matching and effects and different kinds and dropping some loops or mixing with free decks and stuff. So, and that, this is the interesting stuff about you. You look for something that normally doesn't happen. So you look for rock and metal stuff and bringing it into the electronic stuff with a different kind of crossover that's not so much in the bigger picture.
I know what you mean. I don't understand why it's not a bigger sound, honestly, but I think it might be making a comeback. Like, it was a thing. I mean, obviously, mixing metal and electronic music, or rock and electronic music, or just there's even a whole article in Wikipedia about it called "Electronics and Rock Music." This is a tale as old as the beginning of rock. I gave the example of Pink Floyd. Like, how old is Pink Floyd?
Yes,
and they already were using synthesizers. Like, yes, it wasn't like dance music. It wasn't. They didn't have this beat thing on it, this loop thing. But we're talking about tempo synced arpeggiators that are generated by synthesizers. It sounds like pretty much like electronic music to me. So it's always been there, really. I think this whole thing of like the metalheads being like, oh, real metal is only done with guitars and whatever, and
then you have all shit. The dark moody stuff laid out with pads and stuff.
Exactly. So then at the end of the day, it's like it's always been there in a way. Yes, I mean, more power to you if you don't really want to do that. You don't have to. That's great. But I also don't get this whole. Why should there be a division between it? As in that there's a, you want to do a certain style that requires a specific number of instruments and specific elements. That's great. But I never understood this whole like, oh, electronic music and metal don't match. I'm like, dude, they've been there together since the beginning of rock. Like, do you guys know what Ministry is? KMFDM. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the Spawn soundtrack with that track with Atari Teenage Riot and Slayer. I mean, this is not new. You know what I'm saying? A lot of kids want to claim it like it was their own. Like, no, bro. Like, I'm sorry to tell you, but first of all, I've been doing this for almost 20 years, and I don't claim it as my own because I know where I got my influences from, and I respect the people who came before me. To me, that's something that's really, really important. It actually kind of pisses me off when I see kids out there like, oh, like I'm like the guy. I'm like, no, bro, this sound does not belong to you. And I don't understand this because it's like, I think the second people start fighting for that, like, oh, this is my sound, this is what I did, then it actually, it's counterproductive for the scene. This happened a lot in the UK drum and bass scene, actually. Like, those guys think they own drum and bass. Like, drum and bass is the home of drum and bass, is the UK, and everything else that is not UK drum and bass, that's just like, it's weird stuff. That's too heavy, or that's too odd. Bro, the entire world, like, drum and bass became such a big thing. They all develop scenes. Like, you know, Russia has a lot of amazing producers, Hungary as well. Like, what are you gonna say? Like, Eat Brain doesn't have credit because it's not from the UK. Like, what about all the Dutch drum and bass producers, Wax on Empire, Pythias? Like, are you freaking kidding me? Italy has amazing producers as well. Spain, South America, North America. I mean, and it's like, I think it's amazing when this sound keeps spreading, because, you know, it would be the equivalent of, I don't know, Ozzy Osbourne saying that, oh, everything else that was made outside of the UK with guitars is not rock, it's not metal, just because, you know, we invented it. Like, I mean, thank you for bringing that sound to the world, but I mean, you could also argue that there were things before that happening maybe in other places.
Always,
but
every time. But
either way, it's dumb to try to like, you know, lay claim on something like that. Like, music is universal. So.
Everything is a remix. So
there you go. And
if you start from the beginning of rock and roll, Robert Johnson and stuff, before there was a word of rock and roll.
Yeah.
And
there you go.
The 50s and 60s bands started to cover old folk songs and old blues songs and stuff, and became rock stars with it. So there's this always ongoing thing. And
exactly. They dated the origins of funk to a Peruvian band, actually. Like, they discovered this Peruvian band. They just didn't call themselves punk. But it was, I think, the oldest recording that had a sound like this. Mm. And it was like this Peruvian band. I forget their name. They just didn't know they were playing punk. They were just playing whatever they wanted to play. And when you hear it, it's like, yeah, this is like Sex Pistols. Like, so what happened here? You know, you never know.
Yeah.
So this is what I'm trying to say. Like, I think eventually we all somehow discover similar things, and then we give like our own interpretation of it, and then we influence each other. And this is how music continues to grow. The second someone tries to like claim something as their own, it's like that's just toxic for the music scene. And it gets them nowhere anyway, because the music's going to continue happening. You know, they can just be grudgy and jaded. It doesn't matter. It's going to continue happening. So that's the point. You know?
So what do you think about starting nowadays to make music or start as a DJ? What do you think is different, and what do you think is a good way to get your foot in the door or stand out as a musician? Is there right any now. Idea? Because the level of ground noise is so high nowadays with all this stuff that's going on. Would you agree?
It's a really tough time to start making music. I think so.
But
I wouldn't discourage anyone from doing it. But, I wouldn't discourage anyone from doing it. Like, go ahead and do it. Either way, I think being creative is part of human nature. We should actually do more of that. But yeah, it's definitely interesting times to decide to be a musician. But at the same time, like you said, there's too much ground noise. There's too many things happening at the same time and being released all the time. And the attention span is becoming shorter and shorter and shorter because we're being constantly force-fed with all this information that's pretty much useless, I think.
Yeah, so, nowadays, a hit is something that people used to make their TikTok or Instagram short videos. And if you are on these tracks nowadays, you're really big in the game. It's completely ridiculous in some kind of but
if I miss the old times, sure,
musician, but it is Friday. I started to chat some months ago with some dudes from my studio apartment. Mm-hmm. I have the band house, and they played one of their first gigs.
Okay.
It's a really small young band, and it's fine. It was in a little venue. And if I see these young bands, that's something I really, really enjoy, because they start out and they want something. They don't know how to get there. And they don't know to express it in the right way. And they
they're hungry and they're excited.
Yeah, they're hungry and they're excited. And that's the kind of really cool thing to see, especially for the younger generations. It's nice to make something creative and stuff. So why do started to wear a mask? Because just to stand out, or just that's a good marketing point.
I think in the beginning it was a marketing decision, but you know, it was back then when nobody was really doing it, or very few people were doing it, like maybe Deadmau5 and Daft Punk, that was it. And you had like Slipknot, like Kiss, but you could still count them with your fingers. You know, there wasn't a lot.
Yeah, there was always Guar and stuff, and this dates back to Alice Cooper that became Vincent became Alice Cooper, and then back and forth, and then he always almost killed himself. And
look at
Kiss and stuff. This whole thing with an attitude and different person you became on stage. This is something.
Yeah, it's definitely there. You cannot escape it. I don't think I am the exact same person when I am on stage. But even if I wasn't wearing the mask, you become something else when you're on the stage. It's like you're a little god for the time that the show is happening, because you're pretty much, you know, you're literally playing music in front of so many people that are dancing to it. That's like there's a very powerful power dynamic happening right there. So I think it's beautiful. I think it's amazing. Like, you know, people are like, you sort of have this responsibility, and your responsibility is, you know, to make these people happy, to get them to sort of have maybe a catharsis in a way. That's the way I see it. At least I feel like that's my responsibility as an entertainer, to get people to sort of let off some steam in a way. That's why a lot of my music is heavy. It doesn't have to be heavy all the time. Like I said, if I don't feel like writing heavy music, I will not do it for the sake of it. I'll write it when it's when it's necessary, when I want to do it, when it inspires me. And yeah, the mask, obviously, in the beginning, it was a marketing decision. I wanted my logo to be remembered, and I did this logo of my own, of this mask logo thing. And obviously, in the beginning, I just had it like in jackets and whatnot. And then I figured it's a logo that's based on a face, my own face. So I figured, why don't I put it on my face? Like, why don't I put a mask on? And but when I put the first mask on and I look at myself in the mirror, I think something clicked here. There was, that's what I realized.
There's some hide stuff going on.
Exactly. It was like, this isn't just a marketing decision anymore. Like, there's something going on behind this. And I enjoyed that power for long enough until I didn't. Like, I think it's cool, but I think I did go a little bit through maybe through that similar process that, you know, Vincent and Alice Cooper. I think the sardonic guy was taking over a little bit too much. Sardonic guy, I feel, is I didn't necessarily write a personality for him. It was just what he became. It's basically a completely fearless person. And that gets you, you know, that gets you places, especially in the music industry. You have to be very fearless. You have to be willing to, you know, to lose everything pretty much, because it's a you have to it's a long way to the top if you want to rock and roll.
Yes, that's right. It's a risky game.
It is a risky game. So, but I don't know, man. Like, I also have personal experiences that kind of maybe I'm getting older as well. Like, I'm 37. You know, I'm kind of, I don't feel like that 18-year-old that's always just angry for the hell of it, and I'm a rebel without a cause, and I'm angry against the world just because. I mean, I could, I'll still give you a list of things why I am, but I'm not angry anymore at the world, because I don't really allow anger in myself anymore. I have better ways to deal with that. Even when I feel like I'm faced with some sort of injustice or something being, something that I'm, if I'm approaching a situation that I don't agree with, or something, or something's been done against me, I'm a bit more assertive these days. You know, you, especially moving to Germany, taught me that, you know, South Americans are maybe a little bit more hot blooded, so to say, and we're fine. We get along like that. It works for us. But I learned the art of German diplomacy, and I think it's been very good for my life in many regards. Because it's amazing how people can, like, completely destroy someone just with a very precise argument. It's amazing. Like, even just if you know the right words, if you can cite certain laws or things here, like, it actually gets you to places. And I think that's a lot better, because, you know, you start to realize, like, yeah, a lot of this yelling is not really necessary. You know what I'm saying? You really have to get all like, ah. So I kind of chilled out a little bit, I would say. And that also affected my music in a way, I think. Like, I try, if you compare my sets from like 20 years ago, well, not 20 years ago, but 15, 10 years ago to now, there's definitely a little bit more of a, there's some heavy elements in it, but it's more musical right now. At least I try to make it a bit more musical. I'm more interested in that, in making it a sort of deeper journey, a bit more rock and roll, less death metal in a way. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So,
yeah, and you have a new album upcoming, I knew. You told me about it, and it's not quite, it's ready in all means of recording and stuff, but
it's soul delivered, as in the label has it. The label has all the stems, all the instrumentals, all the deliverables that they required for the release of the record. The graphics are done. It's pretty much, I just don't want to say the name of the album yet. I don't want to say anything about it until this is, I think we'll really, really start with the promotional campaign. I can give in a few details. Like, I can tell you about some of the collaborators. Like, I have a track with Shining, which is a Norwegian band that I very much love, and also for some reason I became
Fear Factory.
Fear Factory is not on the record, but I managed to get that was the one of the main things that I had, one of the main highlights of the year before I started working on my record, which was that I had the opportunity of making four remixes for the new Fear Factor remix album. Mm. And well, it seems that people are loving the remixes. And yeah, I think it was a great opportunity. And then, yeah, we'll see if I get to work with Dino in the future. I think that will be really interesting. I mean, he seems to be interested. He even said in an interview that he wants me to be part of the team. Like, there's this was picked up by the Latin American media, so I guess according to that, I'm a new member of Fear Factory. I mean, I haven't confirmed what's really going to happen, if it's just going to be studio work, if I'm going to do anything live, if it's going to be part of the tracks or the whole I'm still yet to talk to him. He's right now touring, so it's going to take a minute before that happens. But there's a few demos. I know there's a few demos of the Fear Factory album already in the process. So I'm assuming I'm going to get a call soon, and then hopefully I will have the time to do it, because that's something that really worries me. Dino, his schedule is a little bit all over the place. Fair enough, he's a busy guy. But, you know, I also got a whole schedule that's full until May as of today. So if he calls me tomorrow and he says, if he tells me tomorrow, man, yeah, we need all the keys done by February, can you do that? The answer is going to be no. I obviously don't want to say no, but that's what's going on. So, I'm looking at the schedule. It's going to be like, yeah, well, maybe I could push this. But that's just, you know, this is kind of is who he is. So if you're going to work with him, I guess that's something that you have to take into consideration. I like the guy. I love the fact that he gave me an opportunity to work with a band that, you know, it's pretty much one of the reasons why I do what I do. The Remanufactured record, another great example of a, you know, of a marriage between electronic music and
metal. This was the album that Russ Felber from Frontline Assembly produced, I think.
Russ Felber and Junkie XL as well.
You know? Exactly. Yeah.
So, yeah, Russ was also on the new remix record, of course. And I love everything that guy has been doing for forever. So there you go. That's another example.
How old is this stuff? Are we talking about the first half of the 90s, I think.
Exactly. So it's funny, you know, how you were saying that, you know, yeah, metal and electronic music, they're like so part of. No, man, it's been together for a while. Maybe
Skinny Puppy and stuff. So
Skinny Puppy, Nine Inch Nails. I mean,
exactly.
Yeah.
Ministry and so on.
Ministry, so on. Marilyn Manson, or freaking what else?
No, all
Pitch
stuff
Shifter,
we grew up.
Filter.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we even Linkin Park. I was never like a huge fan, but, you know, I respect talent when
I
hear it.
But the whole new metal stuff brought a very big influence in it. It's new metal, as hard as it gets critiqued sometimes, it had an influence, and I think more than this whole dubstep thing did back when Skrillex and stuff was a big name.
Yeah. I always had a hard time with dubstep. Actually, I was never a fan. Not of the old school dubstep, not of the new school. It's just I just could never connect with it. There was some artists that I liked, of course. Like there were things that I found were really interesting, but to me, it was more like chill out music. I don't understand how that works in a dance floor. But at the same time, I see that, you know, times change. For example, it's really funny how when dubstep started, right, it was like this really atmospheric, slow sort of
dub music,
psychedelic trip, and then this really heavy version of it that started happening in America. That was the thing that took it to the mainstream. Nobody was expecting that was going to happen. And now, on the side of drum and bass, you know, started being heavy and really noisy, and it was great for a while, but it never became much of a mainstream thing. Besides maybe what Pendulum was doing, which is also rock and drum and bass. There you go. There's another example. And then now there's this tendency in drum and bass to make things more minimalistic. It's a bit more like deeper sounds. And I understand why it works, especially when we hear it in like a warehouse, which has no acoustic treatment whatsoever. And it's all just this huge wash of reverb. You know, when you have really dry music, it takes advantage of that. And it sounds great live. It actually sounds great on DJ set. So I get why, but I still cannot connect with that. I feel like it is just, there's not enough stuff going on. You know, to me, I'm like, I need a full wall of guitars and a 64 voice super saw or something like that. I like when there's more information in the music, sort of in a way, a la Devin Townsend in a way. I really like the music that he's always done. I think it's like, you hear like he comes with like a barrage of information. His metal is very, his way of composing is very euphoric, you know?
Yeah, fine. Nice.
Yeah.
So I think we have to talk again, especially when your new album is out. And
for sure.
Maybe as a guest in our normal live stream. So for everybody who looks at us for the first time, we do a weekly show called Sequencer Talk every Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. Yeah. And we talk about music production and general music gear and stuff.
I was about to say, we had a conversation regarding, you know, pertaining to the music industry and metal and influences and whatnot. But like, don't you want to ask a question about, I don't know, how to, am I not supposed to tell people how to do like a synth patch or something?
That would be great. I know you're a guy that did some for the one or other company. Yes, would be funny to see how your approach is to make a good sounding drum and bass sound or stuff.
But yeah, so I had the chance to work with Arturia in a few of their synths, namely, well, mostly Pigments. Pigments became one of my favorite synths, and it all started because I got the job to do something for it. But I had never looked at it before, because at some point you're like, man, you get enough stuff synths, and then I open Pigments and you realize, no, I don't. And then I'm between Pigments, and now I'm supposed to do something for a Faceplant as well. So that's got to be my next synth I'm going to tackle.
Faceplant is cool, yes.
Yeah, I love that thing too. It's mostly a thing of time. But that's one of the things that is scheduled all the way. I told you I had this stuff until May. So next year, I'm doing also a preset pack for a Faceplant. So stay tuned. There's got to be a lot of things happening.
Yeah, I think next time we should talk about more about your real production, how you treat your samples and stuff, and how do you record, actually. Yeah. Would be really, really funny. Yeah.
Clip everything. Distort everything. That's it. No, I'm kidding. But it's so funny because this is actually how you get a lot of this, you know,
harmonics, these crazy collapsing harmonics.
Yeah, I'm very, I mean, a lot of the time you can get away with just a little bit of FM goes a long way.
Yeah.
Making something sound like it's distorting, because you're just adding harmonics. And that's what distortion is, ultimately. You know, it's just exciting all these harmonics from a sound source. And but what I meant, like, clipping was sort of like a cheeky joke. But the truth is that drum and bass mastering pretty much consists on that, just slamming the master bus and hitting ridiculous loudness targets. And it works. I think it works when it works, and when it doesn't, we should let it be. I think. Aiming for a specific loudness target, be it -3 LUFS, is just as unproductive as trying to aim for -14, which is this new obsession because Spotify normalizes everything. The reason Spotify normalizes all this stuff is because Spotify has everything and anything from classical music, which has a way more dynamic range, to Anger Fist, which does not need any dynamic range. Like, what's
it's
the
just
point?
Block.
Exactly. But it doesn't mean that it's bad. It's just a genre. So every genre is going to require different things. I like to have a little bit more headroom because I use more instruments and more things that, you know, if you clip them too much, then it doesn't help the song. But if it helps the song, I say go for it. If it doesn't, I think this is much more important because at the end of the day, you know, we're caring too much about LUFS, true peaks and all this stuff. And the truth is, at the end of the day, and get this through your heads, because when I heard it the first time, I could never forget it. And it's the best advice I could give anyone for production. Sound does not care how it looks like. It's that simple.
You have to listen.
That's it. It does. I mean, sure, if you got nice tools that help you, that's great. I use them myself. But the thing is, only you know the value of using a specific compressor or a specific saturator or whatever visualization you, whatever information you get from visualizers and stuff like that. If that helps the music sound better, then that's great. But at the end of the day, what really matters is what it sounds like. And if it doesn't sound good, period. It doesn't matter if your true peak is correct or not. It doesn't matter if you hit a loudness target or not. I was having this this discussion with a kid that wrote well, you know, you have to hit this or else you're not going to be played. I'm like, dude, if your music doesn't sound good, you're not going to be played, period. So that's, you have to make it sound right. Good. That's it. So yeah.
Yeah, nice.
That's a great way to close the interview, I guess.
Oh my gosh.
It's Sunday. It was a pleasure, was a pleasure as well, man.
I hope to see you again.
Whenever. Let me know.
I hope to.
When are we meeting again? What are we doing again? When's the next Super Booth, I guess?
That's, I think in May or June.
Yeah, it's too far. No, I'll come to Leipzig. You have to show me Leipzig. I want you to show me Leipzig.
That's a good plan.
There you go. All right.
So,
all right, brother,
everybody, thank you for listening and watching our little interview. And I hope you have a really great day. Bye-bye.
Cheers, guys.